Good morning, my name is Christian, and I am going to talk about our work Separation of Memory and Processing in Dual Recurrent Neural Networks. This work has been done in collaboration with Luis Lago-Fernández, and it is carried out at Universidad Autónoma de Madrid in Spain. To get started, I would like to introduce the concept of interpretability. Do you think that recurrent neural networks are understandable, or it is just a black box model? There exist some techniques that provide us the interpretability when we talk about machine learning, but it is still difficult to find a good approach to understand the internal mechanisms of a recurrent neural network. So, we work with a simple approach to find this interpretability. If we train a network to learn a regular language, it is possible to match a recurrent neural network to a deterministic finite automaton, because these networks are Turing equivalent and they can model formal languages. To get this equivalence, we must go on with a procedure called rule extraction. This way, we can extract an automaton from the internal network behavior. However, this procedure has two main problems. First, you know that the activation of the recurrent layer is usually the hyperbolic tangent. So, this activation has a continuous range of values between minus 1 and 1, and we need a quantization technique to discretize these continuous values. If you have to discretize the activation that you can see in the figure, how would you do that? We usually use some thresholds to binarize the neurons, and it is not a good point. What is the difference between 0.1 and 0.2 in the activation of a single neuron? Now, I changed the activation. This time, we can perfectly discretize the activation, right? I have to say that we were working on a methodology to binarize the full activation to minus 1 or 1, and we focus on the stability of our method. It consists of adding some Gaussian noise in the pre-activation of the recurrent layer. I am not going to deepen on this, but if you think about it, the Gaussian noise disturbs the pre-activation, so the network must learn to deal with it. If the pre-activation is close to 0 in a tanh, the noise will strongly affect the final activation. However, if the pre-activation has a very high value, adding some noise will not change the final activation at all. Thus, the network learns it and puts its pre-activation at the limits, minus 1 or 1. So, the first problem is solved. Now, the second problem is that there is an overload of the recurrent layer. It must learn and keep all the time dependencies of the input, and it also must process the information and predict the answer. This overload can limit the capability of the network to learn. Remember that we are learning a regular language. A Moore machine is an abstract model that identifies the family of the regular languages, and its response depends on just the current state. The figure is an automaton with the alphabet A, B, that switches the state every time that one symbol A appears. If we consider the response 1 as accept and 0 as reject, this is, of course, the language of strings with parity of symbol A. With the Gaussian noise technique, we can extract a Moore machine from any recurrent neural network trained on this. But there exists another equivalent abstract model, the Mealy machine. It is usually simpler than the Moore machine because this time the response depends on the current state and also the input. So, the point is, how can a recurrent neural network behave as a Mealy machine? Now, I begin with our model architecture. When we work with a recurrent neural network, its output depends on just a hidden state. Here, I show you the two classical Hermann equations, where the output y depends on the hidden state h. Please note that this is the noisy activation function, where we add the Gaussian noise multiplied by the previous state to deal with a possible regularization penalty. Which is our strategy? We need some additional connections in the architecture. We already have the recurrent layer connected to the output, but a Mealy machine also depends on the current input, so we need to connect the hidden state together with the current input in a new hidden layer that combines them. This way, the new model's output will depend on the input and its current state. So, here we go with the dual recurrent neural network, the new architecture. We just simply add a new layer C, with also a hyperbolic tangent activation function. This layer processes the current input X and the current state H, and then this new layer is connected to the output. Maybe it is easier for everybody to see this model in a figure. Here, you can see how there is a direct connection between the input and the feedforward layer C. I want to stop here and think aloud. If we consider the hidden state as external, the model just receives the input and some information from an external memory. Indeed, this is a simple feedforward network with a single hidden layer whose response depends on the input and the current state. Remember that the second problem with the rule extraction procedure is the overload of the recurrent layer, because it must learn the time dependencies and also predict the answer. Now, the recurrent layer does not predict the answer, because it is just the input to a feedforward network. Thus, there is no more overload, and the second problem is also solved. The following question is, does the dual recurrent neural network really behave as a Mealy machine? I begin with the experiments. Our main goal is to interpret the dual recurrent neural network as a Mealy machine, and we do it with a rule extraction procedure by using the noise activation function in the recurrent layer. And to do this, we are going to learn some regular languages, the Tomita grammars, and the addition of two numbers in different bases. The Tomita grammars are seven regular languages that are a common benchmark in rule extraction. These languages are built under the alphabet A, B, and their deterministic finite automata have no more than six states. An interesting point of these grammars is that the Moore and the Mealy machines have no differences in their states. This is an example of the Moore machine on the left side and the Mealy machine on the right side for the Tomita 6 grammar. Strings, where the difference between the number of A's and B's is a multiple of 3. In these machines, we begin in the state with an arrow, and then we transit again and again between states with the corresponding symbol. When we finish processing the string, in the Moore machine, we will answer with the value in the current state. On the other hand, in the Mealy machine, we will answer with the last value from the transition. The number 1 means that the string is accepted, so it belongs to the regular language, and the 0 means that it is rejected. The problem of the addition of two numbers on different bases is a different story. Here, the Moore machine needs more and more states when we increase the base. Why is that? Because we need 2 states per digit in the base. For example, this automaton with base 2 needs 4 different states. However, this time, the Mealy machine doesn't need it. Whatever the base, the Mealy machine will always have 2 states. Why is that? Because the output is explicitly in the transition, and the states work as a kind of memory to remember the carry. So, the Mealy machine is simpler than the Moore machine. When increasing the base, Mealy just adds more transition, keeping its complexity, while Moore needs more and more states, increasing this complexity. Now, I begin with the results. I will show you that the dual recurrent neural network behaves as a Mealy machine. First of all, it is important to explain that, whatever the problem where I am testing the dual recurrent neural network, the output of the neurons in the recurrent layer is always in these two modes. Either they are binarized around time, being always minus 1 or 1, or they are always regularized, being 0. In this figure, I show you the recurrent activation of the dual network when it is trained on the Tomita 6 grammar. Look that neurons 0, 1, 2, 6, and 7 are regularized. I mean, their activation are always 0. So, we can discard them because they are turned off. On the other hand, look that neurons 3, 4, 5, and 8 are fully binarized, being minus 1 or 1. With these neurons' activities, we can perform the rule extraction and directly get the automaton. The procedure is the following. We have the neurons either binarized or regularized, like in the figure. Here, only the neurons 0, 2, 8, and 15 are active. So, we can extract the two principal component analyses and plot them in a two-dimensional space, like this. You can see that the activation vectors are clustered into 8 groups. The real dots are drawn in red, but for a better visualization, the clusters have been expanded in blue. Then, we have to analyze the deterministic transitions between the clusters. Here, I show you an example of the transition from the orange cluster to the others with the three possible symbols, dollar, A, and B. Whenever the network is in the orange cluster, it always does the same transitions. So, if we do the same for all the clusters, we can generate a transition table. Then, we just need to minimize this transition table, and finally, we can get the minimum deterministic finite automaton. First, the results with the automata grammars are the expected ones. We obtain 100% of accuracy on all the tests. It is not surprising, since the LMAC network also does it. Their behavior and complexity are similar, since the Moore and Mealy machines are also similar. When we extract the minimum deterministic finite automaton from the LMAC network, the picture on the left side, and the dual network on the right side, we can observe that they are the automata that solve the regular language, which is, in this case, the automata 6 grammar, and also that they correspond to the Moore and the Mealy machines. I want to say that the same results are obtained for the other 6 automata grammars. Before I go on with the addition problem, I want to ask you, what do we need to add up two numbers? 5 plus 3 is 8, so we need the two digits. But what happened with these other two numbers? 56 and 34 is 90. In this case, 5 and 3 don't sum 8, but 9. We also need to remember the carry, and this is the key to understand the potential of the dual network. When the LMAC network is trained on the addition on base 2, it gets 100% of accuracy on the test, and it behaves as a Moore machine. Look at these pictures. They represent the activation of each active neuron when there is, or not, a carry. The top picture is the activation when there isn't a carry, and the bottom one is the activation when there is a carry. Black color is minus 1, and white is 1. Look how the neurons 0 and 5 are combining their activation to give the answer, while the neuron 2 is keeping the carry. Whenever there is a carry, the activation of the neuron 2 is 1, while always there is not, its activation is minus 1. This is a cool result. We can understand the LMAC network internally. We understand the behavior of the neurons and we can, of course, extract the automaton. But what happens when we increase the base? This is an example of an LMAC network when it is trained on the addition problem in base 10. This time, the network doesn't reach 100% of accuracy. It is around 99%. And here you have its activation patterns. This time, even if the patterns are cool, they are completely difficult to follow, so we cannot understand what is going on here. Now, let's go with the dual network. I show you here the activation patterns of the two active neurons. It is important to say that whatever the base, there are always two active neurons, and the rest are turned off. This time, the recurrent layer behaves as an external memory, and it is just remembering the carry. In this example, the neuron 0 is just looking at when to activate the carry, and the neuron 2 is just keeping the carry in memory. I have to say that I have placed the automaton of base 2 for simplicity, but all the other bases that we consider generate the same automaton just with more additional labels in the transitions. In conclusion, in this work, we have built a new architecture, the dual recurrent neural network, where we separate the recurrent layer from the processing of the output. In this case, the recurrent layer behaves as an external memory, and then a simple feedforward layer combines the input and the information in this memory to process and give the final output. We have deepened the interpretability of recurrent neural networks by training a dual network on identifying regular grammars, and we can say that the dual network can be directly interpreted as a Mealy machine. And it is also important to say that the new architecture gets better performance than the LMAC network, and it seems to make a better use of its computational resources. Thank you for your attention.